Stop grouping objects in Graphics Designer. Let me show you a better way. I've been getting a lot of questions and comments on customized objects in WinCC, and a lot of people think that these are just glorified groups, but they're not, and there are some great reasons to use them instead of groups. So here I'm making a short video on what customized objects are, how they're created, and the advantages of using them in your project. Now, you all are probably familiar with grouping objects. Groups are just collections of objects that are lassoed and grouped together so you can kind of move them around more easily. However, customized objects are much more efficient and user-friendly than groups. Here's why you should use customized objects instead of groups in your WinCC project. Customized objects are more efficient in runtime than groups because they lose the overhead of the individual components that make them up, and they're seen as one object by the runtime graphics engine. However, when groups are loaded into Graphics Designer, they are treated just as a bunch of objects, and they will take longer to load and to animate. Customized objects are also easier and more intuitive to integrate into your WinCC project, since you can create your own set of custom properties and events. While customized objects are not global in nature, you can drag them into your global or project library and use them when needed. You can even transfer them to other WinCC projects simply by copying over PDL files to the new project with the objects on them, or transferring the entire project library file. The process to creating a customized object is simple. Just use a standard palette of drawing objects to create your objects and make it look the way you want. It's important to name each component accordingly to make creating the properties interface much easier. Once your object is designed and all the components are named, it's time to transform this into a customized object and create your property interface. Let's see how that's done. Now that we have our object drawn and everything is named appropriately, to create a customized object, you just lasso everything, right click, and do Customize Object Create. This dialog allows you to build the properties interface. So I'm just going to click OK here. Now we have a new object, and notice we don't have any properties. We have a few that are required to just define any object. So can you display it? Operator control enabled, width and height, but we don't have anything else. The types of properties that we want are the things that we want to visualize or animate. We want this fill level to be able to go up and down, as well as maybe change the color. We want to be able to change the name of the tank, as well as put a tag and show a number here on our level. So that's what we're going to do. I'm just going to right click again, go configuration dialog, and we can give it a name here. I'll just call it special tank. And then I'm going to rename this property topic. So see this user defined, this is the same thing here. Let's call this tag assignment. And we'll start with the IO field. Now I can pick the IO field out because I named this appropriately using Hungarian notation. IO means it's an IO field. Tank level tells us what it does. So it's a big thing of mine in my classes that I teach, that I make sure that everybody names everything appropriately. Now we'll use the output value. This is where you assign tags to an IO field. And I'm just going to drop it right on top of tag assignment. And I'll rename this. And we are just going to call this tank level. And I'm just going to click OK. Now you see that the property assignment has changed to tag assignment. There's special tank. That's the type of object that this is. And I have got a property for my tank level. And if I put a number in it, then it is going to change the output value of the IO field. And that's exactly what customized objects were made to do. If you know that fact, you're 95% of the way there. So I will right click and do configuration dialog again. And it is also good practice to go open theme selection and go ahead and put in all the standard themes that we're used to seeing and put those relevant properties there. You don't really have to, but I like to do it. So all of your text-based stuff will go under font, your widths and things like that will go under styles, your colors will go under colors. So let's do our fill level color. There's my rectangle fill level. I'll just find my background color, put it under colors, and then I am going to change the property here and just call this fill level color. Now there is also, this has a gradient, so we would want to do our fill pattern color. And I'm going to make it a separate property, so I'm going to drop it under colors here, and that'll allow me to change the gradient. Now for the tank name, we'll go to our text tank name. The text property is what allows us to change that text, and I'm going to drop it under font, and then I will just give it a new name and call it tag name. Now we want to do our fill level. Well, this fill level is going to be 0 to 100 because fill is always by percentage. But it's going to be the same value as what's on this IO field here. So what we want to do is we will find our fill level, and I am just going to assign it also to this exact same property here. What that's going to do, and I'll just click OK and show you, is now since both properties are tied to this one, you can see that both my fill level and my output value change when I change this one property. And that's the other really important thing you need to know about configuration dialog. As long as the data indicates the same thing, you can put it under the same property. So for instance, if we wanted to do font size, so we've got three things that do a font size. We got our tank name label, we got our IO field, and we've got our units label. So if I wanted to do my tank level and go find my font size, I could just drag this over here under font. And then for tank units, I'm going to do the same thing. And then also for our tank name, I will go find my font size here. Close this. Now if we go to font, then now I have the ability to change all of my font sizes as I want to. And that's it for properties. Now I will right click again and come back in. Also, there are events. And so if I want to have an event, say when I click the tank name, then I could just go find my tank name, and I can actually hold my shift key down and press as many of these as I want. And these have to go under object events. Notice that it gives me the no sign here. So I drop them here. And now I have a place that I can put events when the tank name label is clicked. And of course, I could also do, say, the IO field. If I wanted to find my IO field here, I could also pull this over. And then when I click, these are going to show up under my user defined. So you can do events as well as properties. Now, one thing I'd like to show you, if I duplicate this, and so this is going to be my customized object. Here, I'm going to do customize object delete, and it's going to revert back to just a regular collection of objects. And then I'm immediately going to lasso everything, and I'm just going to group it. So here's where it really pays off to do customize objects. So if I look at the properties interface here, it's very nice. I've got all my stuff out here. But if I look at the properties interface here, I've got this giant collection of all these different objects, and it's very difficult for me to go find out exactly what I want to animate or what I want to change. Look at all these properties. And so this is why groups are not good. And if you remember, when we go into runtime, the graphics runtime engine has the overhead of keeping up with all these objects, whereas on our customized object, it doesn't. It's only got these properties to deal with. So that's why customized objects are much more efficient. So I'm just going to get rid of this group. One last thing I want to show you. Let's say that I need to add something to this tank, or I need to go change the base property of something. I can right click, go to customize object, edit. It puts it into the edit mode. And let's say that I just want to have some kind of warning down here. So I'll just say that this is our low level indicator. And the idea is that this would be shown if the tank gets too low. So we would default it maybe to yellow or something like that. And then we would set our display to no. So by default, it does not show. And of course, we're going to give this a name. So we'll call this text low level. And then to get out of the edit mode, because notice I can't save or anything, I've got to get out of the edit mode. I'm going to come back. I'm going to lasso everything. And again, make sure your cursor is over something that's selected. We're going to right click, customize object, finish editing. And then when we go into our configuration dialog, notice that we have our text low level. If we want to do tag assignment, then I could just say, I'll get the display property of our low level indicator and drop it under tag assignment. And then we will call this low level warning. And that is a Boolean property. So if this goes high, it's going to show. Now, of course, in Graphics Designer, when you're configuring, it's always going to show. So we can hook up a tag as well to show this. So we'll attach some tags to it. I'll go to tag assignment, right click, pull up my tag browser. So here's my tank level. and my low level indicator, which is binary. And then I'm going to go over to the tag dialog, and I'm just going to pull these out as IO fields. So the top one is going to be my tank level. The bottom one's going to be my low level indicator. Make these a little bit easier to see here. And I'm just going to save, and we'll go to runtime. And I'm going to make a little bit of room so I can show the tag simulator. So here's a new trick. Notice this little hand icon right here on the IO fields. That is a draggable indicator. And currently it works with a simulator. And I can pull this, pop it right in the simulator, just like that. So there's my two tags. And for my binary, I'm just going to make it user so we can do it manually. Same thing for this guy. I'll set these both to active. Go to simulate and start. And then I can put in different values into my tank level. Now notice that it's got the little triangle, the warning symbol. That's because these values are being simulated. Now you can go turn that off just by, I'm going to select both of these, and there is a property called visualize tag status. And that's what that means. If it's uncertain quality or something like that, it'll show that icon. We can hit that to no. And now it doesn't show it. Now, I didn't make that property available in the customized object for this, so it's not as easy to turn it off, but I think you get the idea. We see that the level indication works very well. It's going to both. And then I can also put a 1 into the tank low level, and this is going to pop up, pop a 0 in there, and of course it goes away. Now one other thing that I didn't do, I never really gave this thing a name, so let's just give it a name just for the sake of completeness. Let's say that this is tank number 123. That way it looks a little bit better in runtime. Okay, so I know I said there was only one more thing. This is an additional thing that I think is important. So I'm going back to graphics designer. I'll select my tank. Notice that I have set my object name to tank one. And so someone asked on configuration dialog, let's take a look at our tank level and look at properties. Well, we have an automation name and a property name. And what's the difference? Why are they different? Could we change our automation name? So I'm going to show you what that means because it's pretty important. Let's say that I want to have a button that is going to just change the output level. I'm just going to say set to 100. And on the events of this button, I'm just going to do a direct connect. So for my constant in direct connect, I'll just put 100, and the target of this data is tank one. And notice how in the properties list, we have our tag name. I really should have made that tank name and tank level. Okay, so if I just choose tank level, when I press this button in runtime, then it's going to set that. So let's say that we needed to access this on a VBS script. So I will just set this button up. I am going to make a VBS action here on the duplicated button. And I'm just going to put some code to set this. So I'll just say dim my tank, set my tank equal, and I'll right click, do object list, screen items. And you always put the name of the object in quotes. And I'm going to do my object browser here. We are on new PDL 9. There's my tank one. So now I have a reference to tank one. Now, if I do my tank dot, notice it doesn't have tank level or output value or anything like that. And it's because in a script, you can't really get that. So what do we put here? So I'm just going to save this real quick. And we'll go back to our configuration dialog, go back, look at our tank level and hit properties. The automation name, this is what is going to be used if you are writing a script like a VBS script or a C script. The property name is what shows up on your property dialog and it's used by Direct Connect. So could I make this tank level? Yes, but just for the purpose of this demonstration, I'm going to leave it output value and click OK. We'll go back to our VBS script, and now I'll uncomment this and say output value equals, and I'll just do 78 just so it's a different value. Well, I'll change the font here real quick. Set to 78. Click OK. save, go to runtime, and there it sets to 78, there it sets to 100. So to sum up, anytime you are renaming something, the automation name is what's going to show up in script, and the property name is what is going to show up in your properties interface and on your Direct Connect. Okay, so that's all I'm going to do with this object today. The last thing is we'll open up our library. Under our project library, I can right click, make a new folder. We'll rename the folder, just call it Tanks. And I'll double click to open it. We can drag this right in. Then of course we can drag it out onto any screen and configure it. If you want to transfer this to another project, you can just copy this PDL over from the grax of this project to the grax directory of that project. You can also move the library.pxl. I talk about how to do this in our 15 awesome tips for graphics designer. Check it out in my tips and tricks playlist. Okay, thank you for watching. That's all I've got today. If you learned something, how about subscribing to my channel for more great content? Give a hit on the like button and share this channel with your colleagues. Thanks.